This next fly we're going to tie for you is called an EM. We named it after a guy we fished with for years that died when he was 82 years old, but it's called EM for Eldon Mauk. But it's our favorite big fish fly when we go after big browns, especially up in Manitoba, where we've gotten browns up to 10 and 12 pounds, and I tell you, this fly is just deadly. And I think it would probably be just as good on any river as it is on the lakes, but it is one heck of a lake fly. But we make it anywhere from size 6 down to about a size 12. Now this is a size 8 scud hook, and we use scud hooks for it. Either a down eye or an up eye, either one works. But for fishing for smaller fish, you'd probably want to make a smaller fly, but we like to have this one a little bigger. But we try to do certain things on this fly that you don't do on others. We're trying to make different effects. Now we know that if we put a big pusher at the front of the fly, and if we have a skinny tail behind it, that pusher, the fact that the water goes over it, makes a disturbance, and when it hits that tail, it makes the tail go up and down. So one of the things we want to do on here is make a long skinny tail that will bounce up and down. Then we're going to use the whole fly to become a pusher. Now a pusher is like when you make a woolly bugger. If you put 4 or 5 extra turns or 3 or 4 extra turns of hackle at the front, that makes a disturbance in the water, which allows the fish to feel it with their lateral line. So the first thing I'm going to do here is I'm going to start out by applying some lead to this hook. And I'm going to use, in this particular case, 0.2500 lead. And I'm going to start way back on the back of the hook right here, and I'm going to start winding. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times. Then I'm going to take that and slide it all up and underneath that bead, like that. Push it all the way up under. Then I'm going to take what's out and do 1, 2, 3, 4 more turns, then I'm going to break it off right there. I'll try to break it off. Since it won't break, I'll cut it. Now, what I've done here is something that I've actually accomplished something that most people think they've accomplished when they just put a bead on the hook. Most people say if you want a fly to dive, and somebody wrote about this one time, and he says, if you want a fly to dive, put a bead on the front of it. Well, that's totally false. And if you ever watch a fly in the water that has a bead on it, I dare you to get it to dive, because it just won't do it. Most hooks, in fact all hooks, because they're so heavy from this point here down to the point from the back of the hook, they're so much heavier there than they are at the front that when you pause a fly going through the water, it falls backwards. If you put a bead on it that's anywhere right for the size of the fly, the best it will do is fall flat. If you put lead under that bead, now it will dive. It'll go head first. Now you could use a tungsten bead, that gives you a better effect, but a tungsten still isn't as heavy as one of these beads with lead under it. If you want a real heavy fly, use a tungsten bead and put lead under it. But now that I've applied that lead, I've got a fly that will dive. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to make something where a tail will wiggle, and then when I pause, the fly will dive, it'll come back up when I strip, the tail will be wiggling, it'll dive, wiggle, dive, wiggle, dive. A fly with tremendous action, and apparently the browns just love this action because they sure hit it. But now, I told you I'm going to put a big long tail on there. Well, you know and I know that if you take a short hook like this and put a big long tail on it, that when you cast it, it's going to wind around that hook 9 times out of 10, and you're going to be spending all your time untangling your fly, and you won't have any idea if it's even riding right in the water. So to get over that problem, we come up with the idea to take a clump of crystal flash, in this case olive crystal flash, because we're tying a brown olive EM, and I'm going to tie that clump of crystal flash right above the bend of the hook, just like this. I've got a big clump here in my material clip, and I'm just going to place my scissors against the back of my hook and cut straight off like that. Now, I want this to be a big clump back there, so I'm going to do it again. I'm going to spread that material out, bring my thread right back to above the barb, right there, place my scissors against the back of the hook again and cut straight up. Now, what have I done by doing this? Well, the first thing I've done is I've made a bright spot of color that the fish can key on when they strike it. Now, I've also got one here at the front. Now, whether they do that or not, I don't know, but we know that this doesn't detract from it. It just adds a little spot of color. Now, I'm going to take and put the tail in. Now, I'm not going to use a whole marabou feather like most people do when they tie their flies. What I want to do is keep this tail long and thin, so I'm going to take about 1 inch of this material And I'm going to cut these stubs off like this, and I'm going to tie it in right here so that it evens out that body. Now the body's pretty flat. Okay, now I want this tail to be about three times the length of that hook. So one, two, I'll come out to here and I'll break it off about right there. Now usually we make them 2.5 to 3 times. Now that's a long tail. But I guarantee you, when you cast that, 9 times out of 10 now, this spot under here will keep that from wrapping around the hook shank. And like I say, a lot of guys I know, I've showed that to them, and they now do it in on all their woolly buggers because they've had problems with them winding around. Now the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take a piece of copper wire. And I like copper for brown trout, but you could use any color you like. You could use gold, you could use silver. I don't think it would make that much difference. But I want some little flecks of copper shining off that, so I'll tie that in right at the back. And then to just build this body up, just so that that hook shank doesn't show, because that's pretty ugly like that, I'm just going to tie in some crystal chenille, and I'm going to fill up that space. Now, I'm not worried about making a perfectly neat little body, even though I'm not going to make it definitely ugly. I just don't care about how neat it is. I just want to fill up that space. So I'm going to bring that up. It took me 3 turns. I'll tie that off right behind the bead. All right, now I've got a body there, but now I want to make my pusher. So for my pusher, I'm going to use the best quality dry fly hackle that I can find, and that happens to be off of a Whiting saddle hackle. Now I've got a saddle hackle here that's big enough to make a whole bunch of flies, but I'm going to tie it in right at the head, and this hackle is probably big enough to tie a size 14 dry fly. I'm going to tie that in right at the front. Now, you remember when I first started this, I said we're going to make this whole fly, the whole fly body, a pusher. So if we can get a pusher in there for the water to go over, it'll make that skinny tail bounce up and down. So what I'm going to do is make about 2 or 3 turns right there at the very front. Then I'm going to spiral this back in tight turns. You see, I didn't need that body material in there. It's just so that it makes the fly look better. You could have done this with just hackle. Now I'll bring that copper wire over and I'll catch that hackle at the very back and I'll tie it down with 2 turns right there. Then I'm going to spiral this hackle up through the fibers, not to make a rib as such, but just to get it back up to the front and hold that hackle in place, because with them big browns and those big old kipes, they got teeth that if you get cut by them, I'll tell you, they hurt for days. And they're sharp. So I want to hold that together, and I'll tell you what, by doing this, I have never had one of these flies ever come apart, and it has caught an awful lot of big brown trout. So now I'm going to whip finish it right behind that bead. Now, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then we'll do it once more. 1, 2, 3, 4. Then we'll take this hackle. If its stem's too strong to break, well, it wasn't, so I just break it right there at the back. Now we've got what we call the EM. Now that fly, when it goes through the water, because of this pusher, this whole thing is a pusher, the water will go over that just like going over a boulder in a river. And when a boulder sits out in the river, it makes a big wave, but it doesn't wave where the boulder is. It breaks clear back here. So when I pull this through the water, it'll make a disturbance, catch that tail, and this tail will bounce up and down. Underwater photography of that is just beautiful. This tail's bouncing up and down. When you pause, this thing dives. When you start to strip, it comes back up and the tail's wiggling and dives, wiggles, dives. A very deadly fly, named after our best friend Eldon Mock. And when you drop it, I guarantee you, it just drops.